French was extorted in a sense that he didn't understand exactly what he was invited. After these two speeches, I do understand why I was invited. Because I think that after hearing the speeches, which were really very interesting and I think very valuable, I could make a practical example how these theories are implemented. Because I think that the name of the whole exercise, sovereignty and security, is very important, but I think that it was very, very right to think to invert here one more moment, identity. I do agree that these three elements are very connected. And if we see the situation in Ukraine, where we are now, we are attacked by Russia, we are fighting for what in principle? We are fighting to be able to preserve our sovereignty and to defend our identity, our European identity. In principle, what was the problem in reality? Why we were attacked? We were attacked because if you would remember how the whole story started, in 2013, our former government chief used to sign the association agreement with the European Union. And then people went to Maidan, so it was through your Maidan, which through the become a revolution of dignity and ended its Russian aggression against Ukraine. Why it was beginning this association agreement? Why I speak about it? Because in principle, it was the moment when Ukrainian people chosen that they would like to stand by their European identity. It's exactly what was said by my French colleague. Nation exists by itself, and nation, determination of nation, is also about feeling to belong to something. It was exactly feeling of Ukrainian to belong to Europe, to European Union, like a union of identity. Of people who share the same values, the same ideas, and who would like to live in the same coordination, system of coordinate. And here we come to the identity clash of two identities, between Ukrainian one and between Russian one, which resulted in this kind of conflict. Because in principle, and here I do support very much this idea about that Russia is feeling a full member of the European community because of EU rules. If we see two statements, two actions which were made inside in Russia, it is very interesting also to see it from Ukrainian point of view. Only the last years, what do we see what happens? In principle, it's true that it is about making other Athens and rewriting the history. In last month, for example, in Russia was put the biggest monument to Kiev, King Volodymyr, who bring Christian religion to Ukraine, to Kiev. Why it was so important for Russia to put it there? Because exactly of this moment that they would like to identify themselves with this territory, with Kiev, like having roots from there. Why they're speaking all the time about it's the prince of so big nation, for so big country, it's a little bit strange to speak all the time that they are the same nation like Ukrainians, that they have roots from Volodymyr in Kiev. But in principle, it is about, it is a real existential problem, which I think became a problem for us as well, that it resulted in this attack to Ukraine. Because they felt that with our European identification, we in principle deprive them from this attempt to rewrite history and to be, so how they can that, to explain now that Ukraine, from which they would like now to say that they wrote it, choose other system of coordinates. So it was some very difficult psychological problem, I think, for Russians. And in principle, about rewriting the history is only one very vivid example. You see that we are already accustomed to that, that in Russian TV we have a lot of disinformation about what happened in Ukraine, that we are who we are and how we are, but it was a very interesting statement in a few weeks, which I'm sure that you also all noted about the Hungarian Revolution of 1956. And what is very interesting by whom it was said? It was said by Russian propagandist Kisilov, who in principle, usually he was the main person in speaking loudly about the situation in Ukraine, about our nationalistic and other attitude. And so now you know that one of the main ideas that Russia doesn't support the so-called cold revolutions, and this revolution is sponsored by West, and it's not about issue of the people. And now the new historical moment that he inverted here, that first color revolution was in Hungary. So the only thing, welcome to the club. But I think that it is about this kind of rewriting of the history, that in one moment they just stop thinking logically, they just see the idea, and after having this idea, they just put all historical and other things to this system of coordinates. Religion. It is very important moment which about you said, because you see, if we again look to the Ukrainian example, the role of Patriarch Kirill is very vivid in this situation, because in principle he is playing an active role in making bigger attendance to that, that there is only unique church, Russian Orthodox Church, and there is no not only existing, but no right of Ukrainian church to be one independent. Why again it is so important? Because you can't, if you can't separate to people historically, if you can separate to people mentally, religiously, then it is easier to say that yes, we are right when we say that it this part of our nation, of our mental space, should belong to us. And it is the consequence to which Russia in principle came when it attacked Ukraine. And in principle, it's again quoting, it was just a very interesting presentation, and I, you know, that in principle I just changed all my speech because I think it's more interesting to be in line with this presentation. It gives a lot of things to think about. About content between Russia and the European Union, on the border and countries. It's true, if we speak about the interest, what Russia is always trying to present that his sphere of its interest. European Union, in speaking, in principle, it's attractive for bordering countries. It is a big difference. Russia is trying to say that those bordering countries should stay because there is a sphere of interest. European Union says, if you will be ready, probably you will be a part. But also probably sometimes, but because they are attractive, it is a big difference. So it's not a real contesting from the point of view of fight, but from the point of view, I see the biggest contest between two, again, two identities. Because people who are living in these bordering countries, and here, you know, that it is very important thing that we are trying to, in the period of history, we all the time trying to do, in principle, what Hungary also did in 1956, that to say that we are not object, we are subject of the history, and we are able to decide on our own soul, and we should be taken like a country, like a nation, which can decide on its own destiny and not on its own future. You know that, and in this situation, I think that it is very important in current situation to take into account when we are speaking not only what is the interest of Russia. Is it the interest of European Union, but also what is the interest of Ukraine as well? If Ukrainian people are able now to be the only unique nation in Europe which is dying for European values, I think that it at least we deserve some kind of respect to the dignity and to some kind of respect to the will of our people, and to give them possibility to live in this world which they would like to choose. So I think that it is one very important thing which we would like to take into account, and here we come back to the situation with the association agreement. I started with question why it happened in 2013, because in principle, what does it mean, association agreement? It's a document which has a roadmap of reforms. In principle, if we implement the association agreement, it means that Ukrainian standards of life, of industry, of everything, Ukrainian state will function like a state, any state in the European Union, on the same principle, on the same values, on the same standards. What does it mean? That it means that the kind of life, and based on this identity, will be completely changed in the whole country. That is why I think that Russia felt threatened by this thing. But at the same time, I don't think that it, even if in this case it doesn't give to any country, even if it is so big country and a country with nuclear weapons, it doesn't give them right to offend other country, to attack and to go to other territory to kill. I think that it is very important in this current situation for us to have this European solidarity, to remain united with Ukraine, because you know that in principle it is very important to understand the logic of Russia, the logic of the situation, of the whole geopolitical contest. But at the same time, it doesn't mean that by understanding we mean that we should accept it. It was very correctly right about terrorists who made attacks in France. In principle, if you see what was the nature, that they don't accept European identity. They would like to reinforce their identity with other kind of weapons, but Russia does the same with Ukraine. They try to reinforce their identity, to reinforce identity of post-Soviet, post-colonial state on Ukraine. Because we are not accepting, the situation is like this. But we are completely sure that if we have further solidarity and support from the European Union for our transatlantic partners, we will be able to defend ourselves, and in the end of the day we will receive back Crimea and we will restore sovereignty and territorial integrity in the east of Ukraine. We will be able to implement the Minsk agreement, and I will be very glad when after we done it that we have another discussion on that, how it's possible to counter this wish to rewrite the history and to change the world and the world borders as